Hi everybody, thank you for joining us today. For those who don't know me, I'm Darlene McLennan and I'm the manager of the Australian Disability Clearinghouse on Education and Training, ADCET for short. It's wonderful to see many people joining us today with the names that I know, so welcome friends and welcome colleagues. This webinar is being live captioned. For those who it's the first time they've joined us, you can open or activate the closed captions by clicking on the CC button in the toolbar that is located either on the top or the bottom of your screen. We also have captions available in the browser and we're about to put that into the chat box so you can access the captions through the browser. Firstly, I'd like to start by acknowledging that I'm coming to you from Lutjawidda, Aboriginal land, sea and waterways, Tasmania, and I acknowledge with deep respect the traditional custodians on this land, the Palawa people. I stand for a future that profoundly respects and acknowledges Aboriginal perspectives, culture, language and history, and a continued effort to fight for Aboriginal justice, right and rights that pave a way for a strong future. I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians on the various lands on which you are working today and encourage you to put, if you do know the land you're on, to put that into the chat. And I also want to acknowledge any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders who are participating in this webinar. Our webinar today will provide us an overview of the first two research cycles of Universal Design for Vet Teachers Education Project from Box Hill. Annemaree Gibson is a highly skilled teaching and learning specialist who has facilitated teaching professional and development and research and presented in Australia and overseas. And we're also joined by Annie Carney, who is a writer, editor, learning designer and project manager with extensive experience across the education sector. Annie and I are also working on a project at the moment, which we might share a little bit about at the end of this session. Great. Before we begin, just a few more housekeeping details. This webinar, as we said with the closed captioning, is being captioned by Bradley Reporting and it will be recorded. This recording will be available on ADCET in the coming days. If you are having any technical difficulties or do so during the session, please email us at admin@adcet.edu.au. Annie and Annemaree are going to talk to us for around 40 to 50 minutes or so, and at the end we will open the floor for questions. Throughout the presentation, please feel free to use the chat box for each other, to chat to us. Make sure you choose all panellists and attendees. But if you're actually wanting to ask Annemaree or Annie a question at the end of the session, please add that up, add that into the Q&A box. So it just makes us easier if we are having lots of chat in the chat box to actually find where the questions are if it's in the Q&A box. Okay, I think that's all. So I will hand over to both of our wonderful presenters. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Darlene. And welcome to everyone and thank you very much for your time in sharing our learning journey with Annie and myself today. Okay, I'll stop sharing my screen and Annie, if you could get our presentation going, thank you.
Okay, so I'm just going to show you a short video which is a background to our research project. We talked about this at length at the October Vet, a Vetra conference in 2020. So this is just a short video overview. So I'm just going to share my screen and play this video.
This is the background to our Universal Design for Vet Teachers research project. Our definition for Universal Design comes from the ADCET website, where it defines universal design in education as developing course content, teaching materials and delivery methods to be accessible to and usable by students across the broadest diversity ranges. This definition is based on the one originally developed in the 1980s by the Center for Universal Design in the United States, which coined the term universal design as a concept in architecture and the built environment. The application of universal design to the learning environment has developed into various frameworks. Some are adapted from the original seven principles of universal design, such as universal design in education and universal design for instruction. The American organisation CAST has developed a three-part framework of guidelines for universal design for learning, or UDL, that have been widely adopted. In September 2020, the Teaching and Learning Enhancement Team were asked to support the TAFE NDIS requirement to develop teacher capability to teach students with diverse needs. These requirements align with the recommendations in the 2019 NAS Group report on improving access and achievement for students with disability. This report asked, what does universal design in vet education look like? We considered three aspects in the implementation of a universal design in education project. Firstly, we asked the question, how can we support universal design in teacher practice? Secondly, we encouraged a teacher community response and we promoted collaboration. The third aspect was to develop a micro-credential digital badge. At the heart is bringing our teachers together in a community of practice and supporting them. Universal design in education offered effective strategies and the opportunity for best practice in our BHI context and in each teacher's own context. Universal design offered the possibility of reducing the need for self-reporting of disability and therefore reasonable adjustment by designing for the greatest diversity possible. Research included a literature review, searching websites, documents and videos, and secondary data in reports, policies and procedures. But our greatest asset was our colleagues, the disability support teachers, who became our collaboration partners, offering experience, expertise, advice and many ideas. They reviewed all content and emphasised the importance of sharing this work. We kick-started the project with a series of very short animated videos on the seven principles of universal design in education. We thought we could interest time-poor teachers by asking, have you got 90 seconds to learn a strategy and better meet the needs of a diverse range of students, including those with a disability? The structure of the videos was simple and clear. The aim was to break down the principles, clarify terms and give practical examples of their use. We wanted to convey that it was worthwhile and could be fun, so we used a teacher presenter we said was just like you. To decide how best to implement universal design at Box Hill Institute, we collaborated with our in-house specialists and disability support teachers, and we opened it up to all our teachers in a community of practice. The result is a micro-credential short course built around our animated videos and ideas and strategies offered by our expert teachers. Assessment is based on shared experiences and creative responses.
Yeah, thank you very much for sharing that, Annie. Now our next short video is to give you an overview of the research framework. So, I will now present to you an overview of our research project framework, represented here by an image of a steel bridge with many steel girders and lattices intersecting and meeting at various points. Our research project is based on an Educational Management Action Research EMAR model. In the EMAR model, the teacher-researcher systematically addresses an issue using a cyclical process of generating research and developing actions to try out. In fact, the research project is a hybrid of EMAR and Continuing Professional Distance Education, CPDE model, and action research. As per diagram one, stages of action research process, we determined our starting point, clarified the situation, developed action research strategies, put them into practice, re-clarified the situation, analysed our data and theories, a pattern repeated in each cycle. This process provided us with the opportunity to reflect on our project progress, consider participant perspectives, and adapt solutions to our specific needs. This project is also an applied research project. As stated by the Victorian TAFE Association in 2019, the aim of applied research is to solve real-world problems, advance professional knowledge, foster research and innovation, and evaluate the effectiveness. The image on this slide is of a relatively new building at our Elgar campus with its white curved walls and unique sunshades over the windows. This building contains one of many innovative delivery areas, including our nursing simulation labs. Boyer's model of scholarship is also an important element of this project. We explore the scholarship of discovery, the scholarship of integration, the scholarship of application, and the scholarship of teaching and learning. There are two research project cycles. Cycle one, the implementation cycle, which is now completed, and cycle two, the first review, which is still in progress. This project analyses and attempts to identify the effectiveness of the universal design for vet teachers micro-credential implementation at Box Hill Institute, as presented in cycle one, implementation cycle at October Vet. Cycle two, the first review cycle, identified the need to explore barriers to teacher participation identified by the EMAR CPDE process and is still in progress. As stated by Noons and McPherson, a suitable pedagogical model has to be specified and an appropriate educational setting designed. This corresponds with the action planning. The next phase of our action research framework encompasses course delivery in the designed educational setting. This corresponds to action taking, formative evaluation during the delivery, summative evaluation at the end of each module, and follow-up evaluation course are then used to improve the pedagogical model and redesign the educational setting. Action evaluation. From this action evaluation, new needs may be identified that then trigger new cycles. This research project commenced in November 2020 and is followed by four quarterly review cycles in February, May, August and November 2021. Dissemination is planned for February 2022. Within each quarterly review cycle, data was analysed against action planning, action taking and action evaluation to inform a cycle of continuous improvement. This research project will reflect the following EMAR building blocks: organisational context, educational setting, course and program and pedagogic model, an ever-evolving model changing with fluid needs, and will prove to be a valuable change agent. Hence the choice of the image of a very fluid structure to a building, to me representing an ability to adapt to suit its evolving community. Five key elements have also been considered in this research project: purpose and process, support, data sources, the audience, and the expected side effects. Data sources. This mixed method applied research project analyses low-risk sources of information and data. It analyzed literature, Box Hill Institute and industry documents, and the following Box Hill Institute data: net promoter scores, student satisfaction surveys, unit evaluations, and learning management system learning analytics. Now we'll discuss the benefits of the EMAR CPDE model. The model was used to determine critical decision points, pivot, or in our case, pirouette, inform continuous improvement, and determine our research outcomes. The benefits of the Emarcpde model is that it allowed us to pivot, or in our case, pirouette, hence the image of the several ballerinas' feet on point. And it was used to determine our critical decision points. Which directions do we still continue with? And inform continuous improvement and determine research outcomes. Thank you to Boxall Institute for supporting this research project and our amazing community of practice professionals. Thank you, Annie. The next stage of our presentation this afternoon is Annie will now share with you we're now going into our PowerPoint, sorry. I'll just open that now for you. So Annie and I are now going to present to you live the Universal Design Research Project Cycles 1 and Cycle 2, as that's more recent information. And of course, we welcome any questions.
This presentation is about the first two research cycles of the Universal Design for Vet Teachers Education Project at Boxall Institute, where we asked, how can vet teachers apply the principles of universal design in education to support learners of all abilities? This is the story of our journey to develop education resources and the evaluation process currently underway.
Now Annie and I will share with you our research journey through Cycle 1 and Cycle 2 and our future inquiry considerations. The key stages explored in Cycle 1 were collaborate, implement and reflect. The key stages explored in Cycle 2 were evaluate, analyse and explore, and the key stages being explored in our section we now call puddles, which we'll explain further later in our presentation, is pivot and further inquiry. Annie and I have also observed that the EMARCPD cycles also intersect to inform each other at intermittent points. So in Cycle 1, which was completed in 2020, the NDIS TAFE initiated project Universal Design for Vet Teachers was developed to engage and encourage teachers to use the principles of universal design. That means designed to suit learners of all abilities. Still in progress, this cycle two analyses and attempts to identify the effectiveness of our program implementation in 2020 and 2021. Now Annie will share with you our journey through cycle one and two.
Cycle one, collaboration. We'd already developed the series of animated videos on the principles of universal design. To design how best to implement universal design and to further build on the how-to videos, we collaborated with our in-house specialists and disability support teachers. Then we opened it up to all our teachers in a community of practice session as part of our teaching excellence community of practice. At the first session, we played an animated video for each principle of universal design. And one of our expert teachers then described how they use this principle in practice. I thought I could just play you an example of one of these pairs of short videos. This one is on principle 3, which is predictable structure and instruction, just to show how it worked.
The principles of universal design in education. 3. Predictable structure and instruction. This principle is about being logical, predictable and clear. Let's keep it simple. The unknown can be a bit scary. What's in store? So I let my students know what's coming up with a session plan, a dot-to-dot timeline and scheduled pit stops to look forward to, avoiding sudden changes if possible. I ask myself, how easy is it to understand this? Is it logical? Does important information stand out? I've got diverse students with varying experience, knowledge, language skills, concentration levels. I find that straightforward and predictable works for everyone. I chunk things up, put them in a sequence where one thing leads to another with clear signposts. How far is the finish line? Predictable doesn't mean boring. It helps students concentrate on the things that interest them. It's also reassuring and lets students know where they're going. The last gem I'll share is about feedback. The right amount at the right time, not weeks later. Predictable structure and instruction is about being consistent so students have one less thing to worry about.
Thank you. That's a little powtoon. And now I'll just show you the video of our trainer who talks about the same principle and how he uses it in practice.
The aim of predictability is to help the student learn to trust you and to trust what is going to happen in the class. So with lesson planning, I have a twofold approach. It's about your content, what you're going to do, but also the timeline, which is when you're going to do it. So once you have the class planned, you can use that same structure week in, week out. So an example might be, we come into class and have a short chat as everyone gets settled. I'll then go through what's going to happen for the day. And we usually do the harder stuff first. So we'll do our workbooks until break time, have the break, and come back and do a research task or a computer task so that it breaks up the class a bit. The break's always at the same time and at the same length, and the students will remind you when that is, as they know what's going to happen. This pattern is repeated every week for the class, and it gives the students reassurance as they know what to expect. There are no surprises or anything that is going to shake them or distract them from doing their work. I think you also have to be predictable and consistent with your mood and who you are, your temperament and your approach. This will create trust in you as a person. So if I'm having a bad day, my students will never know about it. I'm still going to come across the same way every week. Again, that just creates that consistency in who you are and what's going to happen in your class. My student groups don't do a lot of assessment, so I tend to focus on giving feedback during class time, praising the effort for the work they're doing and the effort they're putting in. That takes the focus off the end result of the assessment. It also encourages a student to do well in the class time.
I'll just stop sharing.
Thank you, Annie. And I'll just now revisit our PowerPoint. Might be a moment.
I'll just add one thing to our community of practice. Just to mention that we have held a second session on universal design where we invited Darlene McLennan from ADCET to share the resources on the website. And out of this community of practice has come the idea of embedding early adopters in our faculties, as some people responded to the content and said they wanted to take part. Thanks. So cycle one, implementation. The implementation included the community practice that I've just described. At the end of the first community practice on universal design, we polled teachers on what they wanted next. They said they wanted more depth on each principle. From that came our decision to build a micro-credential universal design for vet teachers and to make it available to all our teachers. The course was based on our existing resources, the animated videos, and the input of our collaboration partners. So the expert teachers created the videos, like the one I just showed you, offering examples of how they use universal design in their teaching practice. We also included instructions for implementing strategies and guidance to take it all further. Assessment was based on shared experiences and creative responses. Successful completion awards a digital badge. To answer our research question, we started to look at ways of gathering data to identify the effectiveness of implementing the new short course.
I'll now present to you what the data suggests in Cycle 2. And currently we've identified that there is insufficient data due to limited participants and the short time frame. But we ask why. Are there participation barriers or are we too early in the research project? We consider we have arrived at what we call a critical decision point that we have called the data desert. It is an important pivot point and as stated by Merlin Crossley on being comfortable in the data desert, we need to make a good faith agreement rather than a decision. And when you don't know, it is better to be like Socrates and admit that you don't know. Then, in good faith, you can make an agreement rather than a decision. The EMAR CPDE model supports the group to agree on which way to go at this juncture.
The action research process provides us with the opportunity to step back, reflect on our project progress or lack of, consider our participants' perspectives and adapt solutions to our specific needs. One approach was to compare the enrolments of the Universal Design course and a similar course. Both were non-accredited, short course, micro-credentials, awarding a digital badge. And the courses took about the same time to complete. However, the other course was mandatory for teachers and our Universal Design course was not. The uptake for the mandatory course is 2/3 higher than the Universal Design course. So we asked, is this an argument for making the training compulsory? Or do we need to implement communication strategies to inspire teacher motivation? Do we need to move from intrinsic to extrinsic motivation? Possible communication strategies include more intensive marketing, emphasising the what's in it for me for teachers, planting early adopters to act as change agents in faculties, and strengthening our communities of practice. However, as reported by the OECD 2009, some professional development may be deemed compulsory because the skills and knowledge the development activities aim to enhance are considered important for teacher quality.
The Cycle 2 conclusions. What we want to ensure, we want to ensure that our actions are informed by sufficient data. We do not want to develop action strategies to increase participation by leaping to conclusions about what we are going to explore with further inquiry. The EMAR tool, in following the EMAR process, outlines in the first, we have clarified the situation, relating back to the quote from Noons and McPherson, if change can be understood and controlled, then strategies can be developed and success will ensue. This process provided us with the opportunity to reflect on our project progress, consider participant perspectives and adapt solutions to our specific needs.
Further inquiry will be into our emerging themes. We'll inquire into how to obtain adequate data to complete our research, revisiting the original research problem to identify the effectiveness of the micro-credential implementation, adding a sub-question, how can we increase teacher participation? Is it through compulsory participation or communication strategies? Or do we need to commence a wider literature and environmental review? Or is it all three actions?
The acronym PUDDLES was chosen. Principles of Universal Design Development Learning Essentials. The acronym PUDDLES was chosen not to trivialise how to increase VET teacher capability. Abbreviations spread more quickly and are easier to remember if they are distinctive and can be pronounced, and will also work well on the international stage. As stated by Dr. Sharman at Deakin University, acronyms are powerful tools for recalling information, which makes them a fantastic memory aid. VET educators also love a good acronym, especially in the training and assessment or TAE package. In the webinar, What Does It Mean to Use Research Evidence Well in Education? Jenny Donovan from Monash University addresses designing professional development for teacher capability. She says that it's important to recognise our teacher busyness and situate the learning in context when designing professional development strategies to prepare teachers for change and minimise the tendency for default training. Teachers ask, tell me, what does this mean in practice? Based on the suggestions in the NAUS report, the decision was made by the Teaching and Learning Enhancement Team to design the series of micro-learning short opportunities supported by timely in-context examples and relevant support to build further education and higher education teacher capability, hence our image of the red gumboots in a puddle. We're wanting our teachers to dive into these puddles and explore. Vet teachers are highly skilled industry experts. We require vet educators with industry currency. However, with the casualisation, the TAFE sector sees a high turnover of vet teachers. Some sectors are also finding it very hard to attract teachers. Therefore, teachers are not always experienced educators. New subject matter expert teachers are often juggling industry employment, their family, completing the training and assessment TAE course, and also if they're from a non-ICT area, upskilling their digital literacy skills, whilst navigating their way through internal processes and quality and legislative requirements. Therefore, we are in the further inquiry stage to develop some new puddles, such as, have you got 90 seconds? Maybe it's more Powtoons, and we are looking at other potential short bites of information. Another strategy that we wish to implement is our change agents. We've identified that planting early adopters to act as change agents in faculties is very effective or can be effective, as well as faculty pilot programs. The sport and recreation team at Boxall Institute have recently introduced a unit on diversity and have produced guidelines on universal design in sport. They are keen to be early adopters and change agents, so we are going to run a workshop for the faculty where we support them to complete the universal design micro-credential and encourage them to take it further with ADCET's course on supporting disability in VET. Boxall Institute is also very proud to receive the first WAVE Sue Salthouse Research Grant at the Avetra 21 virtual conference in April. The Women in Adult and Vocational Education WAVE Sue Salthouse Grant for Research into Gender and Disability for 2021 was received for us for our project Training TAFE Teachers in Universal Design for Education. After seeing our WAVE Sue Salthouse grant announcement on Yammer, which is one of our internal social platforms, the manager of the Hair and Beauty faculty contacted the Teaching and Learning Enhancement team, offering to be a part of our research and be a pilot faculty. There will be an interesting contrast in data to analyse post these pilot programs with the two different faculties, as each faculty is quite different in its capability level.
At this stage, we have also circled back to research and an environmental scan. What can we borrow? What are others doing that we can emulate? Some of the ideas that seem promising as tools for embedding universal design in teacher practice are rubrics, checklists, and templates. For example, Dublin University College offer all three based on universal design for learning. A Moodle template, a UDL implementation rubric, and a UDL checklist. I'll put a link to their relevant web page in the chat. I'll try to do that now for you.
Thank you. I will also put in the links to the Sue Salthouse Award on the WAVE website and any other relevant websites that we've referenced as well. So our next slide is it's important because we discussed a bit earlier the Boyer framework of scholarship, and it is important in consideration when developing our puddles, as stated by Michigan State University in their key concepts about community-engaged scholarship. innovation and scholarship has significance beyond the individual context, breaks new ground, innovate, can be replicated or elaborated. Our final slide is a list of all of our references for you to refer to post this presentation. Thank you for your time this afternoon.
Thank you.
Okay, so we'll now see if there's any questions.
Great. Thank you, Annemaree and Annie. That's fantastic. So as we stated at the beginning, if people can put any questions they have in the Q&A box and I will read those out. We'll also, just to let people know why people are thinking of some questions, we will put all those links up on the ADCET website as well under the recording once we have that up on the website.
Excellent. Thank you.
So now we need some little music. Any questions, anybody? How's the project been? Has it been well received in Box Hill? Like, is it kind of starting to have more, having more conversations within your organisation around new, like UD for education and UDL for learning as well?
I think there's a lot of interest from all kinds of different directions. People I talk to in different faculties and in different roles have all been doing something. I think a coordinated kind of effort is would be a really good thing, because a lot of the things I'm learning are kind of anecdotal. There's no repository. So that would be an interesting thing to look at. But as Annemaree was saying, the interest from particular faculties and the idea of being able to get a whole faculty on board and have them implementing universal design principles could really change things, because it could take off if it gets rolling. Annemaree, what would you say?
Yeah, I agree with what you said, Annie. And also too, as I mentioned in our presentation, we do have a number of experienced industry professionals who are quite new to education, and navigating all of these new skills can be quite overwhelming. And so we've identified that we need to make how to use these amazing accessibility functions that are available on Microsoft, for instance, and in Adobe Spark, on our learning management system, Moodle. There's all these functions, but it's quite overwhelming for a lot of them, on top of everything else, to navigate how to use them efficiently, particularly if they haven't got strong digital literacy skills. So the ideas that Annie and I have moving forward is to, well, how can we make this easier for them? How can we show them how easy it is to use and share all these functions with their learners to really support those principles of universal design? And hence the design of the acronym and creating these micro learning snapshots of learning.
Great. We've got a couple of questions, which is great, but we've also got a comment. We're just saying that the animated videos were awesome,
Thank you.
Which is great.
Thanks a lot.
We've got a question here of thank you for your presentation. Do you have a sense yet of what the impact of any of the faculty pilots have been on students?
Not as yet. This is all very new. So currently, Annie and another one of our colleagues, Amanda, is working with the sports team, and they're very enthusiastic and have embraced it. So they're our champions in many ways, and the data from there, we can then look after potentially the first semester and analyse net promoter scores and feedback on unit evaluations. However, the other faculty, which is Hair and Beauty, the teachers there are feeling like they need to do more. They're not feeling well equipped. You know, they're not confident in how to use a lot of the functions and the support. So that'll be really cool to see their data after a semester of us having got them to do the micro credential and giving them some quick, give them, it's about, I guess, on reflection, it's about giving our teachers confidence. Mm-hmm. In many ways, yeah.
Just having success in one thing at a time. And I think we all lack that confidence to some extent. I know in setting up this webinar that when we had a practice, we realised that there were some things we were doing that weren't good for accessibility, and we had to go back and rethink them and try again. And there are probably some things in what we've done today that don't quite work. So I think everyone has to keep learning, and I guess as technology moves forward, it'll make it easier, but there'll be also be more things to know about.
Yeah. And I feel like our job is to curate the knowledge and translate it into vet speak for our vet educators, and give them almost a roadmap of how to navigate, and videos to show their learners, so that, you know, Annie and I very strongly feel that, you know, our learners shouldn't have to disclose that they have a disability. So through strong tools such as checklists and rubrics, we can support learners to enjoy that learning journey, feel supported and change the learning resources and materials to suit their individual needs.
Yeah. Yes, and probably their cohorts as well. If we're talking about hairdressing and we're talking about sport and rec, they might not need or want to use the same tools.
Yeah, excellent. Jessica's asked a fantastic question, and it's based on that the challenge I think that we all have when we're looking at, you know, educating individuals and changing practice or informing practice or whatever is time, and that it, you know, often people have the interest in the area, but they just haven't got the time or find the time to actually change their practice. So Jessica was asking about is, other than the training sessions and the early adopters, what else has been some of the impacts for staff?
Well, look, I think one of the biggest impacts was COVID. In many ways, I consider that leveled the playing field for a lot of learners. However, it created a lot of anxiety for our vet educators because of it brings in another favourite topic of ours, which is digital literacy for vet educators. And particularly our non-ICT teachers really struggled. We want to build on that momentum that we've gained. So once, like we stated in the presentation, teachers can tend to default to their previous settings. But during that time in building skills on MS Teams, we were really impressed with teachers saying, hey, I found out that you can turn on closed captions here if you record. And, that community of practice, the impact I saw was the teachers were supportive of each other, wanting to really support their learners and really being nice to, like, everyone was nicer to each other. The students were nicer to the teachers. We were all on the same journey and wanting to make the journey more comfortable for everyone. But there was some major rapid upskilling, and we're still building on that momentum. So I hope that's answered that question in a way. Did you want to add anything, Annie?
No, I think that summed it up.
Right. So in relation to that, I suppose talking about the accessibility features and so forth, one of the questions here is, do you enforce any of the accessibility features through your learning management systems by locking available fonts or other things like that to ensure that accessibility is just a part of it?
There is a template, a shell for our Moodle system that teachers need to use, and that's happened I think that was introduced about 6 months ago-ish, maybe longer. And that does contain a number of accessibility features, and it has fonts. I mean, you can change the fonts, but it does have recommendations, and our brand guidelines kind of feed into that, in that there are certain colours and fonts that you can use. And I think a number of the built-in Moodle interactives and H5P activities have good accessibility, but we know that they don't all have great accessibility, and sometimes the way you use them can make them less accessible. Like if you put one thing inside another thing, if you put an interactive inside some kind of box or something, it might not work so well. So I think there are lots of ways to undo the accessibility, but the short answer is that we do have some things in place, but not enough, maybe?
No. Yeah. And also digital technology is just transitioning and evolving so quickly, so it's actually quite hard to keep up with all of that. But we do, like recently it was really cool, we in working with Microsoft was that, you know, the dyslexia font, and now with accessibility functions on MS Teams, I think an approach we're wanting to show our teachers is, well, here's a video, or here's how to show your learners they can change the contrast of their screens, and they can choose a font to suit their learning needs more. It's more about showing the learners as well, but we have to give our teachers confidence first. It's more about showing the learners how they can use these tools to their advantage. However, we have found that what we have introduced, such as the structure that was described, I found that all learners benefit from these particular tips and tricks and that familiarity and no surprises. But certainly I agree with Annie, we're always working and looking at new ideas, and this is part of our puddles, is creating a checklist. So make it easy, direct the teachers to what the functions are and how they can be used. And also we're in early discussions with an amazing professor at Monash University, and looking at a potential rubric as well of how to overlay the principles of universal design in the structure of the learning management system shells as well, which she has found very effective.
Yeah. Brilliant.
I think there are all sorts of aspects. Certainly, Darlene, when you came to our community of practice virtually and showed us the dyslexia font, that's what really prompted us to look at it closer and to find out how it works and get that going. So I think
we found it on MS Teams. We thought, oh yay, we have got it. So it's more brilliant. About giving people direct, giving them the key to the map and how to use it. Now, I see a question from Louise Markwell. Is the anticipated outcome for the micro-credential to be available for all teachers of VET to access in due course? So certainly we're open to discussion on that. But Annie, did you want to mention to our recent discussion with our manager, Tanya, about the Powtoons?
Yes. I don't know. I think, Darlene, early on when I contacted you, you may have mentioned the possibility of putting the Powtoons on your website, and we're totally open to that idea if you would like to do it.
Yeah, brilliant. We're also thinking of, like, for those who don't know, we're actually in the process, and Annie's a part of that project group, of developing a e-learning resource around universal design. For learning for educators, and we may also look at embedding on that. So we will have conversations because they're great.
Yes,
they're fantastic videos. Yeah, no, brilliant. So yes, the writer of that content, Jen and I, were just texting each other saying, oh, can we get those? So just seeing them again reminded us about how great they are.
That's really sweet. Thanks.
Yeah, we've got a couple of other questions. One was around the student voice. How much did the student voice play in the development and the evaluation of this? Work?
Probably not that much in the development. Certainly will be in the evaluation, because the evaluation will be about the student experience. In the developing, it was mostly coming from teachers who work with students with a disability. And relying on their expertise.
We also, being a vocational education provider, we don't have our own human ethics committee, and so we've had to rely on what is defined by Boxall Institute as low-risk sources of data, and which, so the student voice is currently only represented through net promoter scores and unit evaluations and input from the disability liaison unit and our experienced practitioners. However, in a future project, we are hoping to gain access to a human ethics committee and be able to then interview and survey our students. But currently, yeah, we're restricted by ethics.
Yes, ethics. I think ideally you would start there.
Yeah, that'd be great. And then just probably going across to the staff then of how are you evaluating staff uptake and implementation of UDL principles after they complete the micro-credentials? So I suppose that kind of component of once they've completed, what's happening then as far as gathering evidence and data?
The learning management system we use is Moodle, and it has quite good analytics, learning analytics. And so it's a matter of identifying, well, what do we want to learn from their experience on the micro-credential, and then pick up the data that can supply that information. Then also too, there is some quite good learning analytics, which is still growing, the functionality on MS Teams. So, but once again, due to low risk sources of data, we can only use feedback and information as part of their normal role as teachers. Teachers get, if everyone was researching, they get survey fatigued, as we all do, when we all send out surveys, there's often not very high strike rates. So once again, it is just analysing existing data and low-risk sources of information. But certainly moving forward, we're hoping to expand that data source as well.
Yeah, there's a possibility that using something like a rubric might be a way of gathering some teacher data about what they're using, and kind of using that rubric about how many strategies and what kind of strategies are being used, and the student's satisfaction and how they're moving together. So that's part of our, as Annemaree was saying, our Puddles program.
That's great. All right, well, we haven't got any more questions, but the questions have been absolutely fantastic, and it's been great to see the level of engagement from people. I really want to thank you, Annemaree and Annie, for sharing your journey with us so far. It's great to see this project, kind of in action and the work you've been doing. So commend you both for your dedication and passion to it. And
thank you.
And also thank you for everybody for joining us. Good rest of the week. And and we look forward to hoping many of you join us again for one of our next webinars or sessions. Okay, take care, everybody.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Bye.